Good evening. I have to say, I was a little nervous when I saw the podium because I was here last night and they didn't have it. And I had my hip replaced 6 weeks ago. So doing steps is not something I like to do, even if there's only one or two. So I'll be a little cautious going down. So I probably already said that my name is Deb Mattson, and I want to welcome you to this event this evening. And you've heard the spiel because I recognize faces and you've been here, but I do need to say that on behalf of the Chippewa Valley Book Fest, I want to say a special thank you to the many individuals, businesses, and organizations that have donated funds and services to make this festival possible. And as you know, the book festival is run totally by volunteers. And you can see a complete listing of sponsors in the Book Fest newspaper. And the other thing I'm going to put a plug in is that there is a donation box outside, so we're already collecting money for next year's fest. So think about donating to that. Also, I'm going to make the reminder to turn off your cell phones. And at this time, it is truly a pleasure for me to introduce Jonathan Slaught. I read this book, and as I was telling Jonathan, I love nonfiction, I love science. So I thought, oh great, I'll learn about an owl that I've never heard of. Well, I picked it up and I started reading it, and it's truly an adventure, and you feel like you're right there. I'm sure those of you that read the book were just like, I just couldn't put it down. So, and I had the pleasure of listening to Larry Mueller's show on public radio this past Wednesday. So if you, maybe some of you got to hear that, but it was really a treat to hear him ahead of time. So as I said, the writing, Jonathan's writing is just so vivid. I felt it was right there. And even though I wouldn't want to be in that cold for that many months, I could appreciate that. And just that, the writing to get a sense of the people he was with, the surroundings, the weather, and the challenges to find and capture the elusive fish owl was just amazing to me. And given the circumstances, I thought it was amazing that Jonathan made it through the entire time he was there. And not only did he do it for 1 year, he went back for several years to do this. So it was quite impressive. I really wanted to note too that this book has been recognized. It's won awards, recognitions. In 2020, it was on the New York Times notable book list. It was also on the Wall Street Journal's 10 best books, and then the Smithsonian's magazine best science books. Then in 2021, he was the winner of, and I'm not sure if I'm saying this correct, but the Penn/E.O. Wilson Literary Science Writing Award. It was also the winner of the Minnesota Book Award, which is for general nonfiction. And then also on the Times of London Nature Book of the Year. So I know we're all excited about this, and I can hardly wait to sit down and watch. So thank you.
Thank you. Great. This is a great crowd. Thanks for the organizers for inviting me here tonight. It's a real pleasure. Okay, so as was just mentioned in the introduction, you know, this is a book that came out in English in 2020, and it's already been translated into a number of languages. We have forthcoming still editions from Japan, Turkey, Italy, and Taiwan. And this is, you know, this is a book that I wrote mostly for myself, and thought would attract the attention of bird nerds and Russophiles, so people who are interested in Russian culture. And so this has absolutely taken me by surprise. And yes, it's a book about owls, But I think, you know, one of the reasons that it gained more popularity is because it's not just about owls. It's about people. People that share the same natural resources that the owls rely on. And it's also very much a story about science, about identifying a conservation problem, designing a study, collecting the data, analyzing the data, and trying to convert that into action. So what's a fish owl? These are absolutely enormous birds. Females weigh up to about 11 pounds, which might not sound like a lot if you're not too used to birds. Probably a great horned owl is probably the largest owl in this part of the country, weighs about 3 pounds. So this is about, by mass, it's about three times as heavy as the biggest owl you'll see flying around in the woods around here. They're not three times taller, they're bulkier. They're about the size of a fire hydrant. So before I get into the owl itself, I'll try to hold this thing. Before I get into the owl itself and the story of the book, I want to just step back a bit and kind of show you where the story takes place and hopefully convey that this isn't just one remarkable species in an otherwise mundane landscape, but part of a rich tapestry of biodiversity. So here we are, roughly, in Eau Claire. This story takes place in the southern Russian Far East, a province called Primorye. It borders the Sea of Japan, North Korea, and China, about the same latitude as us here right now. So four seasons, just like here. It's a largely mountainous region with a lot of wonderful wild rivers, breathtaking coast. You feel like you're in a very special place when you're there. The human population density is very low. There's about 2 million people in the whole province, so it's an area about, and compared to Wisconsin, two-thirds the size of Minnesota is the province, and there's 2 million people living there, half of whom are in this one place, the capital city of Vladivostok. And it's in the south, and the further you get away, the further north you go, away from Vladivostok, north in the province, you start to see villages like this, where populations are measured in the thousands, the dozens, in some places even the dozens, so small little places. And because the region's so mountainous and there are all these rivers, the settlements are really kind of tucked where they can fit between these landscape features. The wildlife there is absolutely fantastic. This is probably the most famous, the Amur tiger. And these share the landscape with other remarkable things. There's leopards, there's wild boar, there's bears, there's moose. If you look at this moose, it's the smallest moose subspecies in the world. And if you look at the tines, you look at the antlers, it's more like an elk than the type of moose you would find in this part of the country. It's the only moose subspecies that has that twig-like antler structure. And the brown bears, this is the only part of the world where brown bears and tigers share the same forests. You have this mixture of subtropical species, like the tigers, like the leopards, living with wolves and lynx and moose and bears. Bird diversity is equally fantastic. There's three crane species that breed there. There's spoon-billed sandpipers, if you know anything about birds. They're pretty remarkable. It's one of the most endangered shorebirds in the world. And then 13 owl species, including the fish owl. So I'm going to do a couple of readings throughout this talk, so maybe it was a bad idea to grab this thing. And the first one is my first description of, first time I saw one of these birds in the wild. I saw my first Blakiston's fish owl in the Russian province of Primorye, a coastal talon of land hooking south into the belly of Northeast Asia. This is a remote corner of the world, not far from where Russia, China, and North Korea meet in a tangle of mountains and barbed wire. On a hike in the forest there in 2000, a companion and I unexpectedly flushed an enormous and panicked bird. Taken to the air with labored flaps, it hooted its displeasure, then landed for a moment in the bare canopy, perhaps a dozen meters above our heads. This disheveled mass of woodchip brown regarded us warily with electric yellow eyes. We were uncertain at first which bird actually we'd come across. It was clearly an owl, but bigger than any I'd seen, about the size of an eagle, but fluffier and more portly, with enormous ear tufts. Backlit by the hazy gray of a winter sky, it seemed almost too big and too comical to be a real bird, as if someone had hastily glued fistfuls of feathers to a yearling bear, then propped the dazed beast in the tree. So even among owls, fish owls are strange. There are a couple characteristics. When people think about owls, some characteristics of owls, one thing that comes to mind is their exceptional hearing. And that's really facilitated by their facial disc. If you look at some of these birds, spotted owls in California, great horned owl from my neighborhood in Minneapolis, barn owls from the internet, they've all got these parabola-like features around their face. And the feather structure just channels sound directly to their ear holes. And so some species, like the barn owl, can hunt in pitch blackness. If you look at the fish owl, I mean, a little bit, right? There's a little bit of a facial disc, but not nearly as defined as many other owl species. Another feature attributed to owls is silent flight. And if we look at the flight feather of a Eurasian eagle owl, you look at the top there, on that leading edge, you see these barbules, these protrusions sticking up like a comb. And the function of these barbules is to dissipate sounds. When the owl flaps its wings, the air hits that first and pushes it away. It's almost like a cloaking device. And that allows, you know, an owl to fly pretty silently as it moves through a forest. If we compare that to a Blakiston's fish owl primate flight feather, they're gone, right? They don't have these barbules, so they can actually be pretty noisy in flight, especially if you have an 11-pound bird and it's a quiet night, you know, flapping its way across a river valley. You can hear these things. And so why is that? Like, why would an owl species lose these traditional owly features? Well, let's look at what they're hunting and where they're hunting it, right? These are fish owls, aquatic prey specialists. And where they're hunting is these shallow, rocky waterways, which are noisy, right? And so when my colleagues and I are looking for fish owls, surveying for fish owls, we move away from the water so we can actually hear something. So I feel like if fish owls had the acute hearing of something like a barn owl, they would go crazy from all the noise. So another neat thing about fish owls is their vocalizations. This is a pair here. The male is the one with the sort of his puffed out throat there. And they vocalize using duets. And so it's a four-note call. And duets are extremely rare in birds. And this is a synchronized duet. So the four-note call, it's male, female, male, female. I'll try to play that here. That's call, response, call, response. Okay, and I'm going to read just a few lines from the a description of the duet. Certain noises in the forest, a deer bark, a rifle shot, even a songbird warble, are sonorous eruptions that catch one's attention immediately. The fish owl duet was different. Breathy, low, and organic, the call pulsed through the forest, hiding among the creaking trees and bending with the rushing river. It was the sound of something ancient and in its place. So it can be difficult to pick out among all the other noise you hear. If it's a windy night and the trees are rattling, it can be hard to hear. The other sound I'm going to play is a juvenile begging for food. That thing you can hear from far away. And this next clip here, so this is a female owl sitting on the riverbank. If you had headphones, you could hear the male calling to her, but you don't really want to hear hers here. But what's important is to listen to the flapping as the bird flies away. It's very un-owl-like. So this here, this is perfect fish owl habitat. This is it's a river valley with a combination of two really important features. The first is big trees for them to nest in. Because they're so big and they're cavity nests, they don't build their own nests. They occupy spaces in trees. It needs to be a really, really big tree to fit a bird of this size. So this is 200-300-year-old cottonwoods. So at home on the Mississippi River, I go down to the Mississippi River floodplain. There are these big cottonwoods. Those look like perfect fish owl nest trees. And the other habitat feature is access to prey year-round. Again, it's a non-migratory species, and it lives in a part of the world where, like here, a lot of the water is frozen in winter. And that can be problematic if your prey base is aquatic-based. Conveniently for the fish owls, this part of the world has a number of natural radon gas hot springs. And so places where that radon gas seeps into the river channel, it warms it slightly, but enough to keep certain patches of the river unfrozen reliably year in and year out. So wandering on the forest, if you see big trees, you see open water like this in winter, there's a good chance, though that's looking like pretty good fish out habitat. So here's a quick clip of one hunting. And this water is gonna be probably a lot shallower than you expect. And I've never gotten over that because these, you know, really big birds are doing all this effort and it's plunk just into the water. They do go in. This is typical in winter. In warmer months, when more of the rivers open, they do go into deeper water. I have a colleague from Japan who has observed them, you know, osprey like diving completely into deep pools. But this is the only kind that I've ever observed. So why are fish owls endangered? There's about between 500 and 850 pairs in the wild, between 1,000 and 2,000 individuals. There's a highly endangered subpopulation, mostly on the Japanese island of Hokkaido, and they almost went extinct. Starting about the 1950s, there was this big post-war push to bring jobs. So there are thousands of dams in Hokkaido today, many of them near the river mouth, which then prevent salmon migration. And then they cut down a lot of the big trees for paper pulp. And so they essentially systematically eliminated everything that the fish owl needs to survive. Starting in the early 1980s, they realized that there were maybe 20 pairs left. And there have been very, very dedicated efforts by the Japanese government and biologists to increase that population. They're at, I wanna say 200 birds now. So it's been a really, really nice recovery. On the mainland in Russia, there hasn't been that same sort of conflict. I mean, even these images are of indigenous Dudege about 100 years ago. And you can see they're using boats. So they would cut down these big trees and haul them out for boats. And they would of course fish. And they would even catch fish owls in autumn, you know, because the birds are non-migratory. They put on these thick fat reserves like bears do in winter. And they would catch them then to eat these big fatty birds. But that's not really something that happens anymore. And even until recently, toward the end of the Soviet Union, so this map here shows just Ternay County, which is the northernmost county in the province and the where most of the book takes place. If you look toward the end of the Soviet Union, there were fewer than 200 kilometers of road, so really not very much road. And as I know now, almost this entire county is really good fish owl habitat. If we fast forward a couple decades, we have this explosion to nearly 5,000 kilometers of road. And so roads dictate human use, right? If a road is not in a place, the odds of a person being there are pretty low. But as soon as the roads get in, people can drive in and do all kinds of stuff. So you went from almost no chance of contact with fish owls to this pretty high risk of contact. And this is what got my attention for a PhD project. It's an endangered species, both internationally and also on the Russian Red List and on the provincial level. And so by law, it's a protected species in Russia. You can't injure the bird or its habitat. But if you don't know what its habitat needs are, you can't develop a conservation plan or a habitat management plan. And that was the goal of my PhD study at the University of Minnesota that started in 2005. It was to work with Russian colleagues to find fish owls, catch them, then put trackers on their backs, monitor their movements, and then use that information to develop a conservation plan. And that's essentially what the book's about. Everything I did was in close collaboration with this guy named Sergei Avdiyuk. There were two Sergeys in the book that I worked with. Sergei Surmich, who's an ornithologist, and then this guy who's essentially a highly skilled outdoorsman. He was an engineer at a factory during the Soviet Union. And when the Soviet Union collapsed, he pivoted to the forest and never looked back. And has just spent, he's still out there now, essentially. He's been in some pretty remote places, left to his own devices, and has worked out over the decades how to extract himself from those situations. So he was my main partner throughout the course of the study and a key reason for the project's success. So the first part of the book and the first part of the project was a relatively short 2-week expedition to a remote river drainage in the north of the province to look for fish owls. And this is, Sergei took this photo of me arriving by helicopter. At the time, there was you couldn't get to this spot, to this village by vehicle. It's only by helicopter or by boat in the winter. In the summer, you could take a boat from the coast about 80 kilometers up to this village, or in winter by snowmobile. And so the plan was to snowmobile from this village 80 kilometers down the coast, and then where a logging boat would pick us up and kind of take us back to civilization and look for fish owls along the way. So Sergei was already doing this. I kind of just tagged along to dip my toes into the fish owl waters, trying to learn just how to feel like I was in fish owl habitat. So we had these two snowmobiles, these two sleds with everything we could think of. You can see a barrel of fuel there. There's skis, there's tents, there's food. And we just started going down the river on these snowmobiles, looking for fish owl signs, so evidence that the fish owls were there. Anytime we'd see one of these big trees and there was a hole up there, use the binoculars to see if maybe there's some feathers on the edge, or sometimes even try to get up there. And the key thing was finding these open water patches, because this is where each fish owl territory really only has a couple of these. So if you see some open water and there's no fish owl tracks, I mean, well, that's where you're most likely to see fish owl sign. And this is they're on the ground much more than many bird species, walking up and down looking for a good spot to stop and jump in. And they're pretty characteristic, like these double K tracks. So this expedition was supposed to take place in winter. And because of delays with weather, I couldn't get up to this area in the helicopter until what really turned out to be early spring. And a moment ago, I said that travel was on the river in summer by boat and in winter in snowmobile. I didn't really say anything about spring, and that's because no one up there uses the river in spring or in autumn, because the ice conditions make it dangerous to do so. And so one thing we kept running into was evidence of spring. So if anyone read the book and wondered what a nalid was, this is what one is. It's when things start to warm up and water bubbles up to the surface, flows across the surface in this sort of silvery band and then disappears somewhere. And so when you're kind of careening towards one of these things in a snowmobile, you don't know if it's just a couple inches of slush or it's up to your knee or it's open water. And so we would stop and kind of check these things out and then get across them. Should have said try to get across them. And as we kept going, we kept running into more and more of these. And a few times, we actually encountered open water. It was a river, and there was no way to get. There was no way to cross it. And so we'd get a chainsaw and cut a trail through the woods to kind of bypass the obstacle, get back to the ice, and. Pretty soon we gave up on the fish owl surveys and just tried to get to the coast as quickly as we could, because we didn't want to be stranded. And as it turned out, once we reached the coast, we found out that people had been calling back and forth between the two villages, wondering if we were gonna make it or not. We were the last people that year to use the ice, because we didn't know what we were doing. So that was winter of March and April of 2006, and then spring of 2006 is part two of the book, where it was much more laid back. It was nice weather, and Sergei and I drove around in his pickup truck, kind of driving along that big road network I showed you earlier, looking for owls that we could use in our study area. So we were trying to find territorial owls that were relatively close to a road that we could try to come back and catch the next year. He knew where some owls were already. He and Sergei Stormich had spent about a decade casually looking for owls, so they had about a half dozen that they knew of, and we looked for more. And we would stay either in tents or in these hunter cabins that were around, and a lot of them are left unlocked, because I think that the general sense is, it's a remote area, and the general sense is, and first of all, there's not a whole lot to steal in these places, but there's usually dry wood, there's salt, there's rice or macaroni, and so it's just a place, someone needs a place they'd rather you didn't break down a door or a window to get in, they just leave it unlocked. And so we would use some of these. And on rare occasion, we'd stay with someone that Sergei knew. So this is Vova Volkov in his cabin. Anyone who's read the book, this is the guy whose dad got lost at sea, which is still one of the craziest stories that anyone's ever told me. And we did good. We found about 12 territories that we thought we'd come back and try to catch owls next year. And so in the off season, so in late 2006, I came back to the University of Minnesota. I trained at the Raptor Center and had to actually grab an owl, how to take blood from it, how to put on a transmitter, and then went back in January of 2007 to try to catch them. And no one had really caught fish owls for science before, so we didn't. There wasn't a clear methodology. I'd mentioned that birds had been studied in Japan since the early 1980s. They have caught them there. Usually they catch juveniles, but they're very, because they're so endangered in Japan, they're very protective, the scientists of the species, they're very secretive. And so when I wrote them and said, how do you catch a fish owl, nobody wrote me back. So it was a lot of trial and error, and this picture is a good example of the weirdness of winter fieldwork in this part of the world, because in addition to skis and snow, there's also open water, and you also need to have hip waders to negotiate some of the open waterways. And so the first field season, I went out with Sergei, living in this tent, set up some traps. We went to one of these sites where we'd heard owls the year before, found open water, found tracks, set our traps, and it was weeks of waiting, and it was awful. We had a trap transmitter, so we put this device on the trap so that if it moved, a little alarm would go off and the receiver would make noise. And so we would take shifts in this tent, 4-hour shifts, I think it was, lying next to each other in our sleeping bags. With the receiver had to be in the sleeping bag because it was getting to minus 30 some nights. And I remember one night in this tent, it was my turn, so I had the receiver, and I'd cinched everything up, but only my nose was showing through the sleeping bag. And every time one of us, me or Sergei, shifted, it was so cold that our exhalations had kind of frozen to the interior dome of the tent, and it rained this soft shower of ice onto my nose. And then, it was demoralizing. And so one thing we did during the day, because we'd have these traps out all night, birds weren't coming, we'd hear them, they were there, they just weren't coming to our traps. And so one thing we did during the day was to try to keep ourselves motivated was we would go to some other territories nearby and do reconnaissance, like look for, maybe we can find some other open water. So once we catch these birds, we can come back, or we'll hit the ground running at a new site. And on one of these reconnaissance trips, Sergei ran into this guy. His name is Anatoly. He's a hermit. He'd been living in a abandoned hydroelectric station from the Second World War for about a decade. And as it turned out, where he stayed, this cabin here, so this was the old control center for the dam. It was right on the territory between two fish owl territories. So standing at that open door there, you could hear one pair vocalizing upriver, one pair vocalizing downriver. And Anatoly thought it was nuts that we were in the woods sleeping in a tent. He's like, "Look, I've got a spare room. Come stay with me. You'll be warm at least." And he was right, it was great. So we still had trouble catching owls, so we still weren't getting a lot of sleep, but we had a warm place, and he started to take shifts also monitoring the device, so we got a little more sleep. So it worked out well. And then about a week before the first season finished, we caught an owl. So we were able to, we kept fiddling with the traps, trying different things, and we found something that worked. And we really only had a week before the season ended, because the season ending is defined by the melting of the ice. Because once the ice melts out and all the rivers are open, the fish owl's gonna be anywhere. And so we ended up catching 4 owls in 1 week. So I'm gonna describe the 3 paragraphs of the first capture. And so the way this worked, where the open water, we can't dictate where the open water is. And so from Anatoly's cabin, it was about 0.5 kilometer. Upriver. We approached the trap a few hundred meters away on skis. Up ahead, I saw Sergei's spotlight reveal a fish owl sitting on the bank, watching us. Like one of Jim Henson's darker creations, this was a goblin bird, with mottled brown feathers puffed out, back hunched, and ear tufts erect and menacing. I'd seen other owl species adopt this posture in order to look bigger and more threatening to an aggressor, and it was working. This was a creature braced for battle. I was taken aback, as I still am every time I see one of these birds, by how enormous it was. The beast stood immobile, glaring at us with yellow eyes in the winter dark and illuminated unevenly by Sergei's light as our pace quickened. Everything was silent except for the rhythmic friction of skis on snow and her gasps of exhaustion. The urgency to reach the owl before it freed itself was palpable. My heart stopped as the fish owl pivoted and took to the air in retreat, but the weight of the noose of the trap held and drew the bird softly back to ground. The huge owl moved away from us with awkward bounds along the broad snowy bank, dragging the trap with it until finally, when we were only meters away, the raptor spun on its back on the river's edge. It lay there facing us, talons extended in a gape, ready to shred any flesh within striking distance. In the off-season, I trained in raptor handling at the Raptor Center at the University of Minnesota and had learned that hesitation with a defensive raptor doesn't do anyone any good. I swooped my arm in a fluid motion the moment I was within reach, scooping the bird up by its extended legs. Upside down and confused, the owl relaxed its wings, and I used my free arm to tuck them first against its body, then the body against me as though swaddling a newborn child. The owl was ours. And for reference, that's on page 185, so there's 184 pages of not catching owls before, before that point. Right, and like I said, like once we figured out that that formula, it was pretty easy to catch owls after that. And so this was the key here. It's probably hard to see, but there's a GPS data logger on the back of this bird. And so what this does, this weighs about 90 grams, so about 3% of the owl's weight, which is normal for a bird. And so it sits, it's like a little backpack, little straps go over on the wing, it sort of settles in among the plumage. And what this model does is collect 1 to 2 GPS locations a day, depending on how it's programmed. The trick is that you have to recapture the bird in order to plug that thing in and download the data. So given that these birds are long-lived, there's a record of a bird in Japan, so it's almost 30 in the wild. They don't really have natural predators once they become adults. And the fact that they're so limited in where they can hunt in winter, we're pretty confident that we'd be able to find those same birds the next year. And it paid off. We were able to recapture every single one. Not all the data loggers worked perfectly, but we were able to recapture every single bird. But I will say, so all the funding for this project was largely raised by me, a graduate student, writing grants. So each one of these units cost about $2,000. Most of the grants I was writing was, $2,000 to $4,000, like really small little grants that I was kind of cobbling together. $2,000 was enough food. That was our budget for the food for the season. It was several months of salary for a field assistant. And so strapping $2,000 worth of technology onto the back of a wild animal and letting it go, it was a leap of faith. So after that first season, with just me and Sergei in his truck, we got a little more serious and started driving around in this thing. This is a GAZ 66. It's sort of a quintessential Soviet transport vehicle. And we had modified the back there into a living space. So there's essentially 2 bedrooms. There's a space that slept 3 and a space that slept 2. And we had this, and then kept catching owls. And we had over the 4 capture seasons, 2007 to 2010, a motley crew of field assistants. It's actually not easy to get someone who's interested in spending, up to 6 weeks at a time living in a truck by the river with 2 to 4 other dudes. So it was always me and Sergei, and we were usually in that front room with a little more privacy, and then everyone else would kind of be in the back in this space. So 3 people would sleep on that rug there. So I'm going to get a little bit into the dynamics of life in the GAZ. Okay, so this fellow here in the middle, that's Andrei Kutkov. The 5 of us had been living in the GAZ 66 for nearly 2 weeks, with Sergei and me sleeping in the forward compartment, and Katkov, Shurik, and Kolya nestled like hibernating bears on the platform and back. Katkov, who snored aggressively, slept between the other two. They'd maintained this arrangement seemingly without incident so far, but over a breakfast of the previous night's dinner, a blurry-eyed Shurik announced he was out of patience. Not only did he have to endure operatic explosions a mere 20 centimeters from his face, but Katkov also tossed heavily and flailed his arms in his sleep. Even if Shurik could ignore the cacophony of noise, he could not escape the irregular battering. Even Kolya, I'm going to show you Kolya, that's the guy with the cigarette, even Kolya, who could probably sleep soundly on a rock pile during a hailstorm, agreed. Katkov dismissed these attacks. If you guys have trouble sleeping, maybe you should see a therapist. Your psychological problems have nothing to do with me. Shurik sputtered obscenities, slapped the table with his palm, and asked Sergei for intervention. It was agreed that from then on, we would have one person spend nights by the trap to better monitor that location and to free up some space in the gauze for sleeping. We took a vote. For the foreseeable future, that person would be Katkov. So as I'm a professional wildlife conservationist, and so this is really what it's all about. Like, who cares that I was running around the woods with Russians 15 years ago catching owls? So this river valley here, you can see a couple of things. You can see the dirt road going through the river valley, and you can see the frozen river. Because the province is so mountainous, almost all the roads are in the river valleys. They go up one river valley, cross only when they need to in different drainage, and then continue up a different river valley. So almost all those roads that I showed you on the map before, they're all in river valleys. This map here shows GPS, raw GPS data from 5 birds. So there's a pair down near the village of Amgu. There's another pair inland in orange and yellow, and there's a single male up north in the blue. And if you look at the distribution GPS points, they're all in the river valleys. Out of the thousands of locations we got, something like 6 were not in the river valley. So fish owls are very, very, very much tied to the exact same places where there's this concentrated human use. But that's what conservation biologists do, right? Is they look at these problems and try to find solutions that meet both the needs of the local human population and wildlife, and use science to do so. So you've probably guessed by now, all those roads are logging roads. So when the Soviet Union collapsed, the industry was privatized, there was more incentive to log more, and you've had this incredible invasion, I would call it, of roads going into this formerly pristine habitat. One thing you'll notice, though, if you look at what they're taking, this is birch, this is fir, this is larch. They're not going after these big trees that the fish owls rely on. And so when I start talking about logging, I start talking about owls, a lot of people start thinking about the Pacific Northwest, where you've got a single spotted owl nesting in a six-figure tree. Like, it's not that there isn't that economic incentive here to harvest the nest trees of owls. The other thing that people are going after is fish. These roads provide access, so people drive these roads to the rivers. There's a couple salmon species that spawn here. And so there's a lot of subsistence fishing, sport fishing, there's poaching, but there's also commercial fishing. So like a good graduate student, I finished my degree, published it, and went out into the real world. And one thing that came out of the PhD was coming up with conservation recommendations. And one way that I feel lucky is I haven't been to Russia since October of 2019, but the Sergeys are still there doing fish owl work. And because we came up with these conservation recommendations together in 2011, we're still invested in the region, and we're implementing what the recommendations that we developed. I went to grad school with people who studied, maybe some fish in Minnesota, who got a job in Arizona. So their recommendations are in some library somewhere. There's not a champion still there to push this forward, and we've still been doing it. So the first thing we did was we took the data from the GPS on the backs of the owls, and modeled the highest quality fish locations, fish out habitat across a 20,000 square kilometer area, which was leased to logging. And we gave that map to the logging company. So now when they're putting in a new road, for example, they can look at that map and say, okay, over here is good fish out habitat, we'll put a road in on the other side of the valley. The second thing we've been doing since about 2015 is working with that same logging company and looking at this map. And every year we propose a half dozen to a dozen roads on that big road network that we think access to should be closed. And maybe it's high biodiversity, maybe it's good fish oil habitat, maybe it's good bear habitat, maybe boar habitat. And we present them with this list every year. So since 2015, they don't always close all the roads we want them to. Sometimes we'll give them a list of 10, they'll close two. But you know what, they're doing something. And that's once you have a pile of dirt that big in front of a road, people are gonna keep driving. They'll go fishing, they'll go hunting somewhere else. And then the last thing, this is a little more recent, also since 2015, is supplementing nest sites. There's one territory called Sayon, where Sergey up in the tree, where we were monitoring the pair there for about a decade, and we watched them go through four different nest trees in that time. So it might take 200-300 years for a tree to be big enough to sustain a fish owl, but according to the data we've collected, the tree might only be there for a couple nesting seasons, because they're so close to the end of their lives, and a storm will come and knock them over. This one here, the owls stopped nesting in it because that cavity, it decayed too deep. It was almost like a chimney, and they couldn't get in and out comfortably anymore, and so they abandoned it. So at this site, we went back in, I think it was 2015, and we heard the birds. They were there, they were vocalizing, but they weren't breeding, and we realized because they didn't have a tree left anymore to nest in. So we took a cue from Japanese biologists who have been putting up these nest boxes since the early 1980s. We got a dozen barrels that used to have soy bean oil in them, cut a hole in one, painted it black, attached a perch, and drove from Sergey's apartment up to Sion and put it up in the tree. And we put one of those game cams up there, just a motion-triggered camera, just to see if owls came and what they did if they came to it. They found it in a week and a half. You know, we put a barrel in a tree in the woods, and these owls found it in a week and a half, because they were clearly going up and down the rivers looking for a good spot. And they've consistently bred in this nest box. And so I'm winding up here. I want to say that my job has grown far beyond fish owls now. I work for a group called the Wildlife Conservation Society. I'm a regional director of all that we do in Russia, China, Mongolia, Central Asia, and Afghanistan. The work that I do with fish owls, which is ongoing, is still what I get the most value out of. You know, there are people in my line of work. We can spend careers designing studies, implementing conservation plans. And it's hard to know whether what we're doing has any real impact. And we can say confidently that there are fish owls flapping around Primorya right now because Sergey and I put barrels in trees, and because we've been working with the logging company to reduce the impact of that industry on the owls while also allowing the local human population to also maintain employment. So it's been a truly collaborative project between people from different countries who care about the same thing. But the owls do not always appreciate our efforts. You know what's coming. Okay, great, thank you.
Great, who has some questions? I'm going to go with you because you're closest, and then I'll make it over to the other side.
Could you explain the trapping device mechanism? Is it a grasping device? You mentioned that the bird was held on by a weight.
Right. So it turned out that the actual trap itself didn't matter so much. So if you go to a book on raptor capture, there's nets, there's noose carpets, which are little snares on kind of a piece of mesh. What we found most effective was the lure. So we would put a little box, we would catch a bunch of fish, these little guys, and put 15 to 20 of them in the in an enclosure in one of these open water patches. And then depending on the landscape, if it was clear on the sides, we could put up nets. If it was brushy, then we put something smaller like a balshattery, if you're familiar with traps. The actual trap didn't matter. We could just use normal bird traps, but the lure, like the fish, was what? Because it's hard, right? If you're depending on fish to live, and there's only a couple spots, and all the fish are tiny, if you see 15 to 20 in a box, you're not going to pass that up.
Two questions. Did you ever use an audio lure for these owls? And the other question is, what are their, what competes with them for this fish food source? And are there predators on the fish owls?
Okay, so the first question, did we use audio lures? We attempted to. The trouble was the frequency is so low that it's difficult, certainly with the kind of equipment that a graduate student could afford, we couldn't accurately capture it. So I would have an owl sitting as far away as the corner of this room recording it, and on the record, it sounded like it was a mile away. And so even playing it as loudly as possible, it sounded kind of like what you heard. It wasn't enough. The begging call, if you can whistle, it's pretty easy to replicate. Sergey was an expert at it, and he could eventually call owls in just doing that, because owls are like, there's what owl is in my territory begging, and immediately they would come in. Other questions were competitors. In winter, there's not much. There's mink, which are invasive, and there's otters. We had almost no trouble with anything going after our lures. Given the time of year, because there's almost no birds there. Closer to the coast, the sea eagles, the Steller sea eagle or the white-tailed sea eagle, they're both related to the bald eagle, would become problematic. But they don't tend to come inland into the dense trees in that way. Was that it? Was there anything else? Yeah, not much. I'm aware of a yellow-throated marten, which is like a big fisher, taking a juvenile out of the nest. A bear, I'm aware of an Asiatic black bear eating a juvenile on the nest. As far as adults, the only case I'm aware of is a lynx caught one. So it was sitting, the bird was sitting on the edge of the river ice, intently watching the water, and a lynx, just based on the tracks, a lynx kind of snuck up behind it and took it. But that's the only one I'm aware of.
Are you still setting barrels out?
We currently are not. We set out a number of them, and then there was a typhoon that came through and knocked most of them down. Not that one. That one's still the one you showed. That one's still there. Right now, there's only two that are active. Some got knocked down. Others got really exposed. So it's you can see this thing in the tree from far away. And we do, we're a little bit like the Japanese biologists in the sense that we try to keep a little bit of a low profile. There's a strange, what we're doing in the woods is not super clear to the people that live in those areas. They think there's some angle that we're chasing up, that we're hunting them and selling their carcasses, or we're catching them for zoos. And so we try not to advertise where they are. And if you've got this barrel in the tree that anyone can see from the road, that's not great. So we've paused that for a little bit.
First of all, I just want to say we finished the book yesterday, and we drove from St. Paul to see you tonight.
I should have gotten a ride.
But we should have, road share. Yeah. But I just found it fascinating, and I never thought in the world I would find a book on fish owls fascinating. But a couple of things. We're old Peace Corps volunteers, mm-hmm. and we were curious about your Peace Corps experience there, and were surprised to learn that Russia had Peace Corps volunteers. And just a second question is, have you had the opportunity to observe fish owls in Japan?
Peace Corps, yes, it was there for not very long. It was maybe 93 to 2002. I left in 2001, and it ended the year after me. The Russians just kicked everybody out.
Was it in that area?
Yes. Yeah, well, it was, yeah, sort of mostly the Far East. So, yeah, sort of around the Sea of Japan and, yeah, that area, yeah. Yes, I've been to Japan a few times to collaborate with Japanese colleagues. And they've adapted some of our methods because they were just catching juveniles on the nest. They were so worried about hurting an adult. And we were able to show, our data showed that birds that were wearing these harnesses were still, they were surviving, they were breeding, and so we weren't, yes, it must be awful to wear one of these things for a year, but it wasn't a detrimental impact to their survival or their ability to reproduce. And so there's been some really neat work out of Japan now using similar technology. And I've actually, there's a, it's somewhere in Wisconsin, there's a International Owl Festival next week. Well, that's the International Owl Center. There's an International Owl Conference that's close by, somewhere across the river from Rochester or whatever. I don't remember. But anyway, so I have one of my Japanese colleagues is coming. He'll spend the night with me in Minneapolis and then come to this. I'll be traveling, so I can't go to that conference. But so, yeah, we stay in touch. Yeah.
As your database has grown, what kinds of questions are you asking now that you hadn't originally, or behaviors observed that you hadn't originally anticipated?
Yeah, well, our big push now is trying to repopulate areas where the owls have gone locally extinct. I mentioned birds on in Japan, in Hokkaido. There's a few islands that are Russian that are, it's the same subspecies that lives there as well, but they're some places that they haven't had these owls since the 70s. And so this last winter, we sent a crew to try to figure out why. Like, why are there owls still there? If not, why might they be gone? And so trying to find places where we might be able to reintroduce them from other populations in the islands. So if you think about, Hokkaido, it's an island, it's in the Ring of Fire. You've got a lot of owls in one spot. And if you have something like a tsunami or something that comes in and takes out all the forest, you're really putting all your eggs in one basket. So we're trying to kind of spread that out or reduce the risk a little bit by repopulating some of those islands.
Talking about the population, I was just curious what the overall numbers are. So if you started out in 2005, 2006, the numbers you counted and banded, is it stabilized? Is it growing? What's it look like?
I think it's reasonably stable. The numbers now are way higher because they're so hard to find. They're so hard to count. And we've been able to really kind of increase the number of owls that we think there are. Like when we started this work, they thought there were in Russia no more than 400 individuals. And we've upped that to 1,000 to 2,000. And that's just by having a better idea on what kind of habitat's appropriate, and then it's sort of extrapolating because there's a huge area, and 1,000 to 2,000, that's a pretty big range. But part of that is because there's a whole area that we know there's birds way in the north, we know there's birds down where we work. What's in between, we're not sure, but there are probably some there. So that's why there's that big range.
Hi, I'm a little curious about how the owls know where the fish are. I know most owls rely on their hearing, especially when they're in total darkness.
Yeah.
How does owl, and when you're using fish for bait, they're dead and in a box. So what's the attraction there, unless they can smell?
Well, they're live in the box, okay. And so it's like you saw how shallow the water was, right, where they're hunting. And so you put 15 to 20 fish, these little salmon, in a box of that's that by that, it's boiling like a cauldron, right? So they're attracted to the noise, and if you think about a river, right, you've got the grade of a river, you have a pool, then riffle, and then pool, then riffle, pool, then riffle. Where they're hunting is at the riffle, so the spot where the water's shallow, and they wait and they watch. They just wait for the fish. They can see the fish kind of swimming past in that really shallow water where they're really exposed, and that's when they jump in on them. My belief is it's largely visual, yeah. And they're hunting mostly dawn and they're crepuscular, so dawn and dusk. They're not hunting at night. They're hunting in sort of those shoulder hours.
Do you still have to download the data physically?
Well, we haven't put data loggers on the birds since this project, so since 2010, because it's an inconvenience, right, for these poor birds who are wearing these things. And we don't want to do it just for the sake of doing it. So we are developing other ideas now to put new technology on fish owls. And honestly, I haven't gone back to what's available now. My guess is there've been some pretty amazing advances since 2010 in this realm.
My question is, how did you communicate with your collaborators from all these different countries? Was English your main language, or do you speak Russian and Japanese?
I speak Russian. I don't speak Japanese. Yeah. These types of places are, you can't get by if you don't speak Russian. We have, it's been a while actually, but for a period I was getting a lot of requests to volunteer, to come over and volunteer. And my first question is, how's your Russian? Because you can get into some dicey situations, and if you can't articulate what the problem is, that's dangerous. So that's sort of the limiting factor. We have had volunteers, but they've all had some language, Russian language skills.
It was interesting to me in reading your book that in addition to all the environmental challenges, loggers and everything, the personal issues you had to deal with, one of that I didn't expect after going through graduate research was having people offer you quantities of vodka and try to find that balance. I could actually feel the tension between accepting hospitality and making sure you're there to do the work the next day. And I'm just curious how you made those decisions.
Yeah, and it really was. I mean, it was culturally, it's really important. And, just like any remote place, you don't want to come in as an outsider and immediately make enemies. And a great way to do that is to turn someone down. And so when, Sergey and I would be sitting in Ternay or in Vladivostok, sort of planning where we were going to go that season and at what time. We'd say, okay, we're going to go up to Amgu, we're going to go to this territory and that territory, that'll take maybe 5 days. Let's say maybe it snows a day, maybe if something breaks down, let's add 2 more days, and let's add a day for drinking. So we always added 1 day. We built that in so that it reduced that tension then, because we weren't looking at the clock. We're like, all right, we budgeted this.
Could you tell us about your next book that you're working on?
I could. I'm writing a book now about tigers in the same part of the world. I have a colleague, someone that I've worked with for a long time. He's mentioned very briefly in the book, named Dale McCall, who's here. He came to Russia in 1992 to start to work with Russians to start this. It was called the Siberian Tiger Project, and he expected to be there for 2 years, and he stayed for 30. And he got off a plane in Russia weeks after the Soviet Union collapsed, and got on a plane and left Russia a few weeks after Russia invaded Ukraine. And so the working title of the book is Tigers Between Empires. And the idea is to really kind of show, it's similar in some sense because weird things happen, but to show like what you can do when you're really working together. When you've got, it's sort of like this, but on a bigger scale because it's tigers. When you have people who, from different cultures, different backgrounds, that have the same vision for a future that includes a certain species, and how politics can unfortunately derail that. That's due to the publisher in December. The first draft is almost done.
So I actually have two questions. The first question was, what was the magic bullet that you used to have the paper companies and some of the other organizations that you had to convince to work with the roads and maybe cut down trees a certain way? And the other question would be, if we want to help further this sort of research, now's your chance to plug the organization that we should be supporting. And thank you so much for your work. It's amazing.
Yeah, thanks. You know, I mentioned a little earlier about how there weren't the economic interests, not at the same level of Svart Owls and the Pacific Northwest and this part of the world. I think another key difference is that all of these loggers are from there. So the people that, there's two logging companies that I deal with, the people who run those companies were born in these little villages. Their fathers, their grandfathers, their in-laws hunt the forests, fish the rivers. And so they know what happens when they put in a road. They know the attention that draws and the problems that causes. And so, I think halfway through the book, it's this pile, of dirt from 2006 that they were already blocking off these roads on their own. Because they know that people go in and poach. What we've been able to do is direct that a little bit. Say, okay, you're closing off some random road that has no value. This road, if you close this one, there'll be more deer. And so it's essentially getting at the same problem from different directions. And so, and like I said, they don't always close the roads we want them to, because we think that forest that's low biodiversity value is being illegally harvested, so we're going to block off that road. So there are still some economic interests that they attend to, but they still want to be able to, they want to be able to share these forests with their grandkids. And that's a much easier argument than if someone lived in New York and didn't care what was really happening.
I think we've got time for one more question.
You mentioned a variety of species other than the owls. Did you have a lot of encounters with tigers, bears, other more animals while you were out doing your research?
Yeah, I think pretty regular. The bears are hibernating in winter, which is fantastic. I'm not a fan of bears. And so it was another nice thing that when the season would end, we'd start to see bear tracks. I was like, all right, it's definitely time to get out. Tiger tracks in almost every fish owl territory, because tigers use frozen rivers like highways. I didn't see any tigers with this work, but it was clear that tigers had seen me. And I remember one time I'm walking up the river, and it's sort of minding my own business, and sort of there's these tiger tracks. The tiger had been walking downriver, and then suddenly, foomp, into the woods, and they're fresh. So it's sitting over there somewhere. It heard me coming, and it was over there somewhere, just sort of hiding. Most tigers in this part of the world are really scared of humans, because most humans they encounter are armed, and some of them shoot them. John Ballion's book, The Tiger, takes place in the same part of the world, also nonfiction, kind of describes the history of tigers and poaching. So I don't consider tigers dangerous. Bears I consider dangerous. And I'm glad that they're not there in winter. Yeah.
Well, I hope you all will join me in giving our speaker a round of applause. Thank you very much for being here tonight. I will let you slip out over to the signing table. So if you have a book and brought it with you, you can take that over to get signed. Otherwise, I'm sure Daughter's Books outside would be happy to sell you a copy. And also on your way out, please grab a festival flyer. There are plenty of awesome events tomorrow as well as Monday. So if you want to continue the book festival fun, please do so. Thank you very much, everybody.